Welcome to another edition of the Paranormal Zone. I'm your co-host, Tom Spitaleri, here with my great co-host, Bob. We're live in the studio tonight. Yay, finally.
Yeah.
That's excellent. Everything's going great. So we want to thank you for coming in, and we want to thank you for tuning in tonight. And we have a great guest. Bob, would you like to introduce our guest tonight?
I would. This is really record-breaking for us because we have on a witch who is from Texas, and she has a story to tell our listeners that they haven't heard before. It's a story of blessings and love and some mystery, I guess. So we want to welcome the Reverend Mother. Welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me. It's a pleasure to be here.
Oh, it's a pleasure having you. You know, you and I had the pleasure of talking to you last week, and one of the things that I was so impressed with is that at a relatively young age, you realized you had this gift. Would you mind sharing that with our listeners?
Not a bit. So when I was younger, I guess I was about 7 when I realized that I just sensed things other people didn't. I knew stuff other people didn't. My mother was a natural witch, and whenever that summer came, my maternal aunt came to visit my mom, and one of the things that they did was divination on the kitchen table to tell your fortune with a regular playing card deck. We knew that mom had some stuff in the closet. You know, we weren't allowed to go into that closet to get anything. But when I showed an interest in divination, she went in there and got me a deck of cards. And it was the top tarot. And I still have that deck.
When you were 7 years old, how did you know that you had this gift? What took place? What events happened to you at that young age that you realized, you know, this is something different?
So it was just always intriguing. Like, how can you tell fortunes by card? How can you just know other things? The intuition just comes when you know something about someone that nobody else knows, you know, and only them. And then they're like, how did you know that?
Yeah, exactly.
Right? And a lot of that kind of things happened to me up into my
teen. And isn't that really probably part of the gift that you would have that intuition?
Right, exactly.
Right. Exactly. Now, the other thing that we talked about there, which I don't think people understand, there are different levels of witchcraft, and they're much different at each level. Can you just talk about the levels to us?
Sure. Well, you know, witchcraft is diverse. There's a lot of different traditions, a lot of different disciplines. It can range from, you know, modern Wicca, which is the modern version of modern paganism, to even solitary people can practice. So each tradition has its own beliefs and methods and levels. And within Wicca, there are different degrees of initiation. It's an ordered structure that you're getting into. These just basically signify that practitioner's progress through those levels. There's also specialized paths, like each of those types of witches focus on that. So in our order, called the Order of Centaur, that's spelled S-E-N-T-A-U-R, we have 6 levels. One outer order level, that's after you've already been accepted. Then there are 5 inner order levels after you're initiated, right. And each level represents a different understanding and mastery.
So, Reverend Mother, and I'm sure this is happening every day, that people have, because it's really now become a male and female interest, correct? You've seen males get involved in witchcraft much more today than you did 20 years ago.
So I think my experience is pretty diverse. I mean, even 20 years ago, there were a lot of men that were in witchcraft, that were interested in witchcraft. So I think maybe it's just the public perception that men are just now joining. But actually, Gerald Gardner was the one that introduced Wicca into England. And he's obviously a man. And then Raymond Buckland introduced it into America. And I'm going to say it was in the early 1970s. But there's a lot of men. And so the Order of Centaur was founded by a man. People like Carl Llewellyn West, Scott Cunningham.
Right.
I think there's a surgence what you're seeing because we're more open. We're more out there now. And especially since COVID and everybody was online doing stuff, it's really become prominent.
And is it fair to say that witchcraft today, at least, is more of a religion and a belief in the universe than maybe what it was 20 years ago or 30 years ago? Or is it pretty much the same?
So Wicca as a religion is the same as it was 30 years ago, 100 years ago.
Oh.
Yeah, so there's a belief that it actually survived everything and came down to us. And there's various books and stuff that they base that belief on. Other scholars have disputed it. So Margaret Alice Murray did a book basically on if witchcraft survived through the burning times in a straight line to today. Right. And scholars have pretty much disproven that. Wicca was basically organized and brought to light by Gerald Gardner, which is a relatively new religion.
Right.
So, within the past,
Well, it, like all religions throughout history, have suffered discrimination and have suffered other atrocities. And, of course, I'm referring to the New England Salem witch trials of the 1600s, which was just a very black mark on our country, certainly. But it survived like other religions survived. Do you think that because of that kind of activity back then, that like other religions, it got stronger because of it?
I do, in so many ways. And, you know, the Salem witch trials were only one of many. There were a lot of witch trials across Europe and England, America, pretty much all parts of the world.
No, there were. And then about, if I remember correctly, 20 years or so after the Salem witch hysteria, they tried it in Hampton Falls, New Hampshire, but the minister up there put a stop to it before it got out, and no one was, you know, killed by it or anything.
So, and right.
It started to show that they, I think that started to show there was some acceptance to it. The old puritanical New England that we live in, that's still around today, believe it or not. I hate to break that news to the public, but it's still here. I think that started showing the difference because that minister up in Hampton wanted nothing to do with what happened down in Salem. Nothing at all. He stopped it immediately.
Right. Well, you know, education and representation play crucial roles in changing perceptions, which is what the Order of Centaur is all about. You know, we're an educational organization for higher enlightenment, and we seek to dispel myths, provide accurate information about witchcraft and our spiritual practices. So we aim to foster understanding and acceptance. And, we don't ever want to see the burning times happen again.
No one wants to see that.
Right.
Right, yeah. Does, you know, when we look at the world of paranormal, by definition, it's something that can't be proven through either science, mathematics, and I always add common sense to it, because I think there are a lot of things in the world of paranormal that you have to step back and look at it from a common sense point of view. But you seem to think, if I'm correct, that witchcraft really does have a scientific universal approach, correct?
Well, it absolutely does. So let me explain a little bit about that. We believe in quantum theory, right? You believe in quantum theory and quantum physics.
Right.
And so they're just starting to catch up with what witches have always known, basically. In the Golden Bough, J.G. Frazier teaches the analogy between the magical and scientific conceptions,
right.
And it's very close. So basically what he said in paraphrase is that the same causes will always produce the same effect. So the proper ceremony performed the proper way, accompanied by, you know, the appropriate spell, will inevitably attend the desired results when performed properly. So when you think about science, that's exactly what you're doing. So, you know, you have to be able to reproduce the effect consistently for a scientific study.
Right.
And that's pretty much what we're talking about here. Energy and interconnectedness. So, you know, like, whenever they look at a molecule, quantum physics, whenever they look at a molecule, the molecule changes to the observed eye, which is something that we've always believed in. So the interconnectedness of looking at that molecule and having it change.
Right. And witchcraft is really rooted, as far as I could see, in connection to the universe. And it's one of the few religions that really looks at it from a universal, you know, being part of the universe, and that the universe is really sending us the messages on how we should proceed, where other religions really base it off, I think, of you know, their beliefs at how the religion started. Does that make sense to you?
Yeah, so there's a couple of things to what you're saying. We are very nature-based, and we have 8 holy days a year, 4 greater and 4 lesser, tied to the cycles of nature. And again, it leads back to the interconnectedness of all things, basically. The seasons, the earth, the stars, everything.
Right.
Down to that little molecule we were just talking about, right?
I actually have a question for you. Up here in New England, we celebrate Halloween pretty big. I don't know if you've been to Salem or not, but 1.5 million plus people show up for that week, that whole month of October. What do you think how they've actually Englishize some of the Wiccan beliefs?
I think it's good. I think that we need to keep our holy days on the public radar. And there isn't a more public holy day for witches than, you know, All Hallows Eve. We call it Samhain. Mm-hmm. And that's, of course, spelled Samhain, but it's pronounced Samhain.
Right.
And that is Halloween, too, or All Hallows. Too.
Right.
The day before All Saints Day.
Correct.
Yeah. It's a great thing to keep it in the public eye. Like, we're here. We really are out here.
And to that fact, you are really on the cutting edge of educating the public to what really witchcraft is all about. Talk to us, if you don't mind, about some of your movements, you will, on how you're educating the public. First of all, you came on this podcast, and I can't tell you how much I look forward to you coming on, because I have been a big proponent that witches are very misunderstood, at least in the New England area, and we have carryover from the 1600s, which is sad to admit. But I'm convinced once people, once our listeners and a broader market gets to hear the story, that we then bring this to the light in education of people, it becomes a different approach to the public.
So, with that, we seek to educate and enlighten. So wherever we are, I mean, I do a lot of social media. Please, I can subscribe. and, you know, we disseminate information that way, but we also have other publications as well. And we have several websites. We have the Centaur, SEN-CAUR.com, Centaur.net, and you can, we have a free monthly newsletter by email. Like I say, it's a huge social media presence. We're opening covens across America, basically.
Wow.
So, I do have an exciting announcement. Have received our official 501c3 designation from the IRS.
Oh, congratulations.
Thank you. Any donations to the Order of Centaur are tax deductible. And that's just one next step, you know.
Sure.
We're opening up a new program. It's going to be called the Witch Registry, where both individuals and covens can register with the Common Congregation of Witches under the umbrella of Centaur. So there's a lot of ways we're going to come together. We are going to come together as the, you know, modern religion that we are, the modern spirituality that we are.
Right.
Well, that's good news. I'm very happy for you. That sounds like a great plan.
So what is the easiest way for listeners to follow you right now?
So just jump up onto centaur.net, create an account. You'll automatically be enrolled in a free introductory course that you can watch that tells you about Centaur, tells you about witchcraft, what we are, what we do a little bit. It's just an introductory course. It's not super long. It tells you how Centaur was founded, a little bit about, you know, some history of paganism and witchcraft and even world history. And then once you finish that, you can the next step is a $25 donation for the basic Wicca course. And both of these courses are certificate courses, so I will send out or email your certificate. More than just an online thing. I mean, we're seeking to touch people's lives. We want to enrich their actual lives, not just their online presence.
Right, right. I'm convinced that we have listeners out here because Tom and I have gotten a lot of feedback over the last few months here about bringing somebody like yourself on that's so knowledgeable and so willing to share. And I know our listeners are going to ask this question of us. If somebody out here today said, I really would like to at least start the journey to becoming a witch, whether it be a male or a female, it's irrelevant today. But either way, what's the best way for them to start that journey?
Well, they can certainly call in. Our office is open regular business hours, and I'm more than happy to give that phone number. It's 325-213-2992. And somebody will be there to answer the phone. Otherwise, there's a voicemail, and we will call you back. But, so the easiest way, the most simple way is to go on to www.sen-tar.net, N-E-T, and get create an account and subscribe.
Could you repeat that, please? We lost you on the phone.
Oh, it's www.sen-tar.net. And signing up is free. So just create an account for free and sign up for our free newsletter. That would be the first thing. So free introductory course.
So. You know, I think you're going to see a lot of people calling in and signing up, but they could also do this through their local covens, right? I mean, I know in Salem, New Hampshire, we have a very large group of witches. So people, are they receptive, I guess is what I'm asking, for people to call them?
I don't know, because we're autonomous in each coven kind of operates independently on its own.
Okay.
And depending on what traditions that they are. So there's, like, in Christianity, there's a lot of different denominations.
Correct.
You know, you've got Southern Baptists and Catholics and Christians and all those things. Well, the same way in Wicca, you know, you have your Suex Wicca, you have your, you know, Circle Sanctuary has their own tradition. They're just a different traditions. The Order of Centauri is just one tradition. So if folks did want to get with somebody locally, they can always check with us. We would help establish local covens and groups, but they could also check with their local metaphysical shop to see if there's an established group there of a different tradition. Those are always options. There's a basic book out that everybody loves. It's called Big Blue. We affectionately call it Big Blue. It's called The Complete Book of Witchcraft by Raymond Buckland. And that's pretty much a go-to foundational text for anybody interested in Wicca.
And where can they find that?
You can get it at any metaphysical bookstore. You can get it online at Amazon.
Oh, Amazon, okay.
You can get it at sen-tar.com. In our store, eBay often has used copies of it even.
Yeah, I think that, you know, to me, that's a great way for someone to begin. Is I think, like, everything in this country is based on history, and I think we've lost as people, we've lost that historic value of even the mistakes we made have payback today if we understand them, so we don't make them again.
Exactly.
And to me, we've made many, many mistakes, but that's part of life and part of the cycle. So to me, I think you have to go back and read as much as you possibly can to understand where we were and where we're going to be in the future. So the next question has to be, where do you see witchcraft going in the next 15 to 20 years?
Oh, it's going to grow and evolve and become more mainstream and integrated into everyday life. And you'll see a witch in a grocery shopping line right alongside a Christian laughing and talking. Mm-hmm. You know, and they're going to each know what the other one is. I think there's going to be a greater emphasis on environmental stewardship and social justice,
right,
reflecting the values of many of our modern practitioners. I think technological advances are also going to play a role with online communities and digital resources, making witchcraft more accessible overall. So I believe it's going to continue to thrive as a dynamic and adaptable spiritual practice. I think it's just going to...
Do you have any idea what the demographic numbers are of people that are practicing witchcraft today in the United States?
Ask me in 6 months. When I get the new program, the Witch Registry, rolled out,
right?
Ask me then. And I'll have some good numbers for you.
Yeah, I'd be interested in that. And that, as a follow-up question to that, is witchcraft practiced around the world?
Yes.
It is. So in foreign countries, other countries, France, England, so forth.
Yeah, so it may be under a different name. It may not be called Wicca.
Yeah.
It may just be called paganism. So all Wiccans are pagans, but not all pagans are Wiccans.
Okay. I've heard that more than once. Can you explain that to our listening audience around the world? Because we got them listening in Europe, United States. They may not understand that comment you made.
Sure, huh? So Wiccans are religion. It's what we stand on as a faith. It's like Christians stand on Christianity. Okay? But there are others that practice witchcraft that may not be a Wiccan. They might be, you know, powwow, or they could be Santeria, like that. They could be different. They could be of a different religion. So witchcraft itself, if we talk about magic being synonymous with the word witchcraft, people can practice witchcraft without being Wiccan. They can practice paganism, druidism, all of those things, and not be a Wiccan. They would be a Druid. And but yet they would still be considered pagan.
Right.
So all Wiccans are pagan, not all pagans are Wiccan.
You know, that really, you really had to do a deep dive into that, because you said that they don't always follow the same religious beliefs.
Right.
What is the one big belief they don't follow that Wiccans do follow?
As far as being, we have the Wiccan Rite, and that is any harm none, do what you will. So you can basically do anything you want as long as you don't hurt anybody. So, I mean, that's the Wiccan Rite.
Right.
They don't necessarily adhere to that. We also have, like, the 13 tenets of witchcraft that was set down by the Council of American Witches in 1974. That was a one-time council that was brought together for the sole purpose of laying down 13 tenets to which all witches could subscribe to. And most of the witches I know today even still subscribe to those same 13 tenets, and they're all over the internet. If you will.
Okay, yeah. Can you explain what maybe one or two or three of them are, some of the bigger ones?
Sure. So I guess the first one that really would resonate is Principle 10. Our only animosity towards Christianity or toward any other religion or philosophy of life is to the extent that its institutions are claimed to be the only way and have sought to deny religious freedom to others and to suppress other ways of religious practice. So that one really resonates.
Mm.
You know, we don't, and we were talking about the burning times before, we don't hold modern Christians in contempt for that. We're not going to hold it against them.
So the question then is, do other religions feel the same way? Do say, Christians, Catholics, Protestants, it doesn't matter. Do they feel the same way to about witchcraft?
It depends on if they're ecumenical. So if they're ecumenical, then yes, they would be, you know, harmonious with our beliefs if they were open-minded enough to take a look at what it is we do. You know, we're not evil. We don't worship anything like the devil. Most of us don't even believe in that. We do, like the fourth principle states, we conceive of the creative power in the universe as manifesting through polarity, as masculine and feminine, and that the same creative power lies in all people and functions through the interaction of the masculine and the feminine. We value neither above the other, knowing each to be supportive of the other.
Right.
Oh. That's interesting.
So, yeah.
That is really interesting.
How far back does witchcraft go in the history of at least the universe, because it's all over, right? So how far back does witchcraft go?
I would say as far back as we can count time, and maybe a little further. I would say at least 6,000 years. They've got, you know, historical and, how do you say that? They've got artifacts right. from, you know, 6,000 years ago.
See, I...
Okay, and 3,500 or 4,000 B.C.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I've always believed, and I've known a lot of people who are in the Wiccan, and like you just said, everybody's a little different. They follow their own, you know, it's like the Catholic Christian religion. They got like many, you know, groups of them.
Right.
But I believe that the Wiccan was going back to the Native Americans or the first settlers of the world. Because, I mean, it's a land-based religion. Native Americans believed in land-based religion.
Well, and that's what I'm saying. Yeah. So, but whether they called it witchcraft or it was labeled witchcraft later.
Right.
So they didn't see it as witchcraft. They saw it as living in society that they knew.
Mm-hmm.
So we're talking about, like, the oak coffin burials and some of those other types of, you know, archaeological finds.
Right.
Where... In the oak coffin burial, they had, you know, representations of the elements, you know, earth, air, fire, water, and it was done in such a way as to bind the directions, you know, north, south, east, west, along with that. So it was obvious that they were doing something along the lines in their society of leaving in the elements and the directions. So, I mean, that's an indication that they did it, even though it probably wasn't
bad. So is it fair to say that it was the Puritan approach to it that put witches in kind of a dark area where they didn't belong? I mean, somewhere along in history, right, somebody, yeah. right, Tom, somebody said witchcraft is bad, right?
Right.
And I can't help but keep deep diving into how that happened or why it happened.
So you have to take that one back a long time. And if we were specifically talking about America,
right.
then, yeah, it would be your Puritans. But it's actually much older than that. It goes clear back into, you know, the 1200s and probably even before the 1200s.
Right.
But for certain, I can name a couple of books that reference witches as being evil and talking against them from a Christian perspective. So it was after Constantine.
Right.
Because prior to Constantine, everybody was pagan.
Right.
right.
You know?
Right.
Right. And then... Yeah, sorry about that.
Yeah, go ahead, Reverend Mother.
Go ahead, yeah.
No, I was just saying, you know, after Constantine... that's when priests and bishops started writing against things that they didn't understand fully. And specifically, like, divination. I outlined this in our advanced book report. But specifically, they spoke against things like divination and casting of lots or stones, bones, if you will. People did that frequently and like, as a group, you know, they would all sit around and cast bones and do those things socially. So the priests started to write against it, and that's when a lot of the persecution started.
Yeah, so it appears that it's typical of the historical faith that the minute they're challenged or somebody challenges their beliefs, instead of looking into it, they react to it.
Right.
Right. I mean, they turn it into something evil because
right.
they don't understand it. You know, in the world of paranormal investigations, we run into religion, believe it or not, all the time.
Right.
And I won't get into it on this podcast, but I have my beliefs in why we, you know, Christians feel that way. But it's interesting to me how that almost still survives today in religion.
Oh, absolutely. So... what I was going to say was the gods of the older religion become the devils of the new, basically. That was coined, I believe, by Margaret Murray.
Mm-hmm.
And basically, they took everything that the common person knew.
Right.
And tried to dumb them down.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
with their belief. And even so back as far as the 1400s, common people
right.
couldn't read their Bible, even though they demanded that, you know, the public worship their Christian God. The common person couldn't read the Bible because it was in Latin.
Right.
Right.
Sure.
Right. The other thing that hurt the Wiccan or the pagan movement around the world not only happened in America, but when the French Jesuits showed up to Canada, they were starting to, they said, oh, we got to bring religion to these people. They already had a religion and a belief, but they didn't believe in it, so they brought it with them to the New World, which was Canada at the time. They did it here in the United States. They did it in South America, all over the place. So it doesn't matter when this happened. These same groups of people just moved up and down. Britain colonized, besides America, they colonized most of the world, the Western world at one time. And all they did was bring their religion with them because these people weren't religious. In quotes, I put that too. Even though they were religious, they had their own different beliefs that they lived for thousands of years.
Well, the Christians sought to suppress other religions.
That is
And
true.
Incorporate their religion, incorporate them even, incorporate their holy days.
Right.
And force the population.
Can you speak up a little bit? It seems like you've gone in and out.
Sorry.
That's okay. No, that's okay. That's fine.
So what else we got, Bob?
Well, I think that religion and this conversation is very, very deep, and I do think I chuckled when you said they wanted to dumb it down, because I sometimes think that religion really stifles people's creativity and thoughts. You know, we have and we're very proud of her, at least at this podcast, that. We tell the story about Goody Cole, which was the first witch of New Hampshire, who was actually tried as a witch. And without getting into the whole story, she was really healing people with herbs. Mm-hmm. And it was a handful, just a handful of Puritans that turned on her and created all of these problems for her, which was sad because what she was doing was helping people.
She kept them breathing.
Yeah, I mean,
right.
You know, and that kind of thinking still prevails today. If you look at what's the witch down in Salem, Laurie Cabot.
Laurie Cabot.
Yeah. Do you know Laurie?
I do not personally know Laurie Cabot.
Yeah. Well, she's been a great representative of witchcraft, in my opinion.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah,
absolutely.
I had the pleasure.
Got a lot of books out.
Yeah, she has, and I've had the pleasure of meeting her, and her story is excellent. And she's tried desperately. Unfortunately for her, I think in the New England area, at least maybe Massachusetts, she's kind of a standalone. You know, she doesn't get a lot of support. From people other than people like us. And yet she's an icon within Salem.
Well, she's certainly an icon within Wicca.
Right.
As a whole, if you can say Wicca as a whole.
Right.
Like I say, I don't know of any registry or anything like that that's brought all of witches together. And I think Centaur is going to, like you said, be on the cutting edge of that. I think we can really do it and bring a common congregation of witches together, even if it's just online, at least, you know, to educate.
Well, I think your efforts are just fabulous. And Tom and I want to make sure that we will help you in any way we can through our podcast. So
wonderful.
Yeah, any creative marketing you come up with, Tom and I would love to help you, because I honestly believe this message has to get out.
It does.
And I believe that you are a pioneer in this field, I've had the pleasure of interviewing two witches on a previous radio program I was on, and I had more great feedback about what they had to say, and they really talked more about the misconception of witches and what they actually did. And I think when the listeners heard this, just that little education, just that 1 hour of interview made a big difference. So Tom and I would like to, you know, offer up our podcast to you for any help we can give you moving forward to get your message out. We certainly would love to interview other witches and get their perception of this. And I believe through your efforts, again, I think you're a pioneer in this field. I really do. The conversation I had with you, which was private, and I'm not going to repeat it on the air here, but it was very moving to me for lots of reasons that I'll share with you offline. But to me, I think that message is going to have a grave impact on people that need it today for all kinds of reasons. We're living in turmoil today, as is the world. It's not just our country. But I think people are really looking. I honestly believe that religion, organized religion as we've known it, is starting to deteriorate. I don't see the generations coming up as religious as I was brought up.
No.
And people,
the world has changed.
It sure has. And we're really reaching out looking for something.
Right. Yes. People want spirituality. They don't want religion.
There you go.
There it is.
Yeah, they want spirituality. And they don't just want spirituality to one male misogynistic Abrahamic God. They want it to, you know, the God and the Goddess, a benevolent Lord and Lady who rules the seasons and nature and the interconnectedness of all of life, rather than a cold, boring church and having to do confession.
Well the other thing too with the paranormal end of this, okay? When I go into a house, I was baptized. I went through all the Catholic rigmarole. Long story short, I asked a question about a money item, line item. I was on the board. And the next month, they threw me off the board of the church. So, now, when I go into people's homes, you don't know what you're going in to clear, first of all, till you get there. Because most people think they got demons. Most of the time, it's not demons. But you don't know what their religion is. So holy water is not going to work for somebody like yourself. That's just not going to work at all. Sage doesn't work for everybody. So you have to have a good understanding of the religious, the people's beliefs, and everything else when you go into a house. You have to keep your mind wide open. And a lot of teams and a lot of people don't do that. And the big churches are notorious for that.
Yeah, so the only big church that I know of I imagine the Orthodox do and the Catholics do believe in exorcism. We do them as witches or pagans. We do them, but we don't. A lot of others do them as well, like ceremonial magicians do them as well. So there's quite a few people other than, you know, paranormal investigators that do exorcisms.
Right. Well, beforehand, it was actually always the Catholic Church or the pagan. It was actually the first lay minister to ever do a, and I never got to meet this guy. I have friends that have worked with these two, but I've never got to personally meet them. The first guy was actually Ed and his wife, Lorraine Warren. They were the first lay people to do it, at least to the public knowledge, let's put it that way. I bet there were more before that. That was in the 60s. I bet there were more people that tried it back in the day, but at least the public knowledge.
Well, magicians did.
Yeah.
Magicians do.
Right.
I know that went back at least into the late Edwardian age. maybe even before that, magician. So John G, he was in Elizabeth's time.
Right.
Elizabeth the first time.
Mm-hmm.
I know they did spirit communication as well. So, yeah. And that is something they have tried to prove with science is, you know, spiritual communication, especially in the Victorian era. Seances were very popular then.
Mm-hmm.
And they really did try to, put some science to it because it was obvious that it worked.
Right.
You know?
Well, here's an interesting little fact. They actually ran seances on one of the most beautiful buildings in the country. You know what that was?
No.
It's a big building in D.C. It's painted white.
Oh, the White House.
The White House.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah, Zachary Taylor's wife was right up to Roosevelt, actually. Roosevelt.
Wow.
So they always had stuff going on in the White House. So
this, interesting.
Yeah, it's pretty, it's not greatly documented, but I know one guy who actually documented and did a talk on it, one of the Parafests.
Yeah. Interesting.
It is.
Very interesting.
Do we lose you?
No.
Okay.
No.
So, when we look at witchcraft and the abuses that it's lived through for all these years, how do you perceive some of the movies and stuff that have depicted witchcraft as evil? I mean, I'm not a big moviegoer. You a big moviegoer?
Not really.
No, I'm not either. But, you know, certainly movies have an impact on people, right?
Right.
You know, I mean, they do.
And I never watch too many. I'm into sci-fi stuff like Star Wars, not so much.
Yeah, but media affects people.
Yes.
Okay, and that's why I say I think what you're doing, Reverend Mother, is the way to go, because media is going to reach more people.
Correct.
Right? Right.
And I know people go to movies for entertainment, but let's face it, we all walk out with a thought. Right? I mean, mm-hmm. That's impossible to avoid, I think, sometimes. So, to me, I think social media is the way to get the message
right.
out. And not just podcasts. I think there's a lot of ways to do it. Websites and... I know you have some other announcements you're going to make in the future. And I'm not going to out you right here, so don't worry about that. But I think some of the things that you're going to do and some of your plans are just so wonderful. So we want to make sure that we stay on top of that with you.
Right. So it sounds like we have to have one a bunch more times.
Yeah. Yeah.
Sounds like fun. So I'll send you some information.
Okay. Well, that'd be great.
Here. And other than that, I just think that, you know, like the movies and stuff that come out of Hollywood are all, you know, bogus. I don't believe any of that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. We've had to combat that stereotypical archetype for a long time. But I think we're making great progress in combating it. I think there's a whole lot more people today that, while they may not be Wiccan, know what it is and know that it's not devil worship.
Mm. So let me ask you this question then. Does dark witches exist?
Okay, so as far as Wicca is concerned, if they go by the Wiccan Rite, any harm none, do what you will, then I would have to say no to that. But yes, the actual fact is dark witches do exist.
Mm-hmm.
And in the Order of Centaur, you can't be a witch without knowing both sides. You have to know both sides to seek a balance.
Wow.
So if you're asking me, do I know how to curse somebody? Yes, I know how to curse somebody. Will you curse somebody? Probably not.
Right. but your folks need to understand both sides of that equation.
Exactly, because you can't have, you know, light without dark, and you can't have dark without light.
Right.
Now, that's not getting into, you know, people that follow Baphomet or any of the others that are into that darker stuff, gothic and darker stuff.
Right.
They're more than welcome to do what they want to do, right? we have freedom of religion in this country, and thank goodness we do.
Oh, that's good. Yeah. No, you know, we would all defend that, you know, as hard as we could. But I'm guessing that the numbers of dark witches are very low.
I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't track that. Not something that, you know, when you're talking about, like, stuff like the Church of Satan and stuff like that, most witches don't even believe in that entity.
Really?
And yeah, we don't believe that it exists. So, you know, we're not devil worshippers. We're not Satanists. Although there are both devil worshippers and Satanists out there, they're not witches, and they don't practice Wicca.
Sure. And that's the, I think, what you're trying to change, that perception. And, you know, with the two witches that I had on a few years ago, actually said the same thing. They said that the message has to get out that there's a big difference, and there are some, you know, Satan worshippers, which they agreed they have a right to do, but that's not witchcraft.
Correct.
That's not witchcraft. That's not the study of witchcraft. So I think it's very interesting that that goes on. And I think the other thing, too, is that people, like I say today, are looking for something. I find that when I'm in that kind of a state, I find nature to be very helpful to me.
Absolutely.
And I don't think enough people turn to nature, frankly. And I think, I do believe in my heart that the universe has a direction for all of us. And I think it's there, and none of us, very few of us, are taking advantage of it.
Right. Yeah. And I can't recommend getting back to nature more. It's like our number one thing. So, like, today is a holy day. It's the celebration of Lammas, August 1st, the first harvest festival. It is a grand Sabbath, and we will honor the harvest. We'll honor the Lord and Lady and the bounty that they give us, and we'll be thankful for it. That's what today is all about.
Wow, that's great.
So this is one of the bigger holidays in the religion, is that correct?
Yes. There are four of them in a year.
So there's this one, and what are the other three?
So this is Lammas. There's Beltane, Samhain, and Imbolc.
Okay.
So or Candlemas.
So what are the dates for those, roughly? I know dates change in calendars.
Right. So now we're just talking about the greater Sabbaths, the four greater Sabbaths. So Lammas, obviously, August 1st. Beltane is May 1st. Samhain or Halloween is October 31st. Mm-hmm. And Imbolc is February 2nd.
So where can our listeners get more information on those holidays?
In the book that I recommended from Raymond Buckland, it outlines all of the four greater and four lesser Sabbaths of the Wheel of the Year.
Okay. And if our listeners go to your website or your Facebook page, they can find that information as far as the book goes.
Oh, you bet. Yeah. So, yeah, we've got a huge online. We've got three different websites. We've got a huge online network of people on the send-char.net page. They just have to create an account. But if they don't want to create an account right off the bat, they can always go to send-char.com. And that's our public-facing page, and it has all kinds of information about Wicca, about Centaur, all of that. It also has a blog that we update monthly. They can sign up for our newsletter, which is free if it's the email copy. And we can also do a paper copy, but they have to make a small donation for that.
Right.
We can mail out a copy to them. So, and other than that... Yeah.
So is the model that you're rolling out with all this activity, is this, are you the only one doing this?
Oh, no. No, no. We have a team. So there are five people on the board of directors for the Order of Centaur.
But I guess I didn't word that correctly. Is this same effort being done across the country with other groups, or...
Now, I don't know. I don't know what other groups do. I just know what Doer Centaur does.
Okay.
I can't speak for other groups because, like I say, all traditions are autonomous.
Right.
They have their own traditions and do their own thing.
Right.
As far as I know, the Order of Centaur is the only one that's going to do a registry.
Yeah. And do you ever see the day that these groups would get together nationally?
I hope. That's what the registry's for.
Wow.
That would be great.
How cool is that?
That would be great.
Yeah, how cool is that?
So. That would be excellent, actually.
Yeah.
Well, listen.
So we'll see. We'll roll it out, and we'll see if we get some response on it.
One quick thing before we wrap up. How do people get a hold of you? I know you said it a few times, but we want to make sure we get it out there.
You can email me. You can call me. So my email is sister.kate@sen-tar.com. That's sen-tar.com. And Kate spelled with a K. And my phone number for the office number is 325-213-2992.
All right. Well, we want to thank you for coming on tonight. It was a great show. Sorry about the electrical blackouts and stuff. There's nothing we could do about that.
No worries. I'm happy to be here, and I hope you have me back. Thank you so much.
Yes, we will have you back on. Thank you.
Thank you, Reverend.
Take
Mama.
Care.
Bless.
Thank you. Bless, too.
You bet.
That
bless
was
to be. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. That was actually a great episode, Bob. I want to thank you for coming in studio today.
Oh, it's fun to be
it
here.
It was a great show. I mean, we had a little trouble, but we got through the show. That's all that matters. So I want to thank everybody for tuning in across the global United States and across the big ocean and anywhere else across the world. And we'll see you next time. We're heading back to the crypts, and we're going to next week we have another great guest.
That's a big surprise.
That's going to be a huge surprise,
yeah,
next,
surprise
week.
Next week.
Big surprise next week. So we're going to keep you in the loop on that. And you can, I might put some feelers out on Essex County Ghost Project Facebook page as we get closer. You'll have to wait and see. But I want to thank everybody for tuning in. Have a great evening, and we'll see you all in the paranormal. Good night.